Good afternoon, Nanda. I am Bharat Kumar, working as an assistant professor in St. Martin's Engineering College, Intermediate Department. So today I would like to explain about the transformer. So first we will discuss about the working principle of the transformer. So the transformer works on the principle of mutual induction. So mutual induction means the flux produced by the coil is linked with the other coil by linking this coil to the flux to the another coil, and induced EMF will be produced in the secondary coil. That is called mutual induction. So these two coils are connected in magnetically. Okay. Now I will explain in the transformer. So if you see transformer, so transformer is the starting device which will transfer the electrical energy from one circuit to another circuit without changing frequency. See here, transformer has two windings. This is the primary winding and this is the secondary winding, and this is the iron core. So the winding which is connected to supply is called primary winding. The winding which is connected to load is called secondary winding. Now see, what is the working principle of the transformer? So see here, we are giving the AC supply to the this primary winding. So that means we are applying this VS. So by applying the VS, the current will be flows in the primary winding, that is called I. So due to I flowing in the primary winding, the flux will be produced. So the flux links with the this primary winding. At the same time, it flows through the iron core and links with the this secondary winding also. Okay. So by linking this flux with the secondary winding, as per the Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction principle, that is called mutual induction principle, and induced EMF will be produced in the secondary winding as well as primary winding. This is called mutual induction principle. So here the EMF which is induced on the primary winding is called E1. The EMF which is induced in the secondary winding is called E2, and this is the load. Okay. This is the working principle of the transformer. Now, so now ideal transformer. Now I will explain the behavior of the transformer. I will start with the ideal transformer at no load condition. Ideal transformer. So here, without loading, I am explaining. So here, we are giving the alternating current supply to the primary winding. So due to that, I will be closing the primary winding. So the current at no load condition, ideal transformer draws a current which is used to produce the magnetic flux phi. This is the magnetic flux. So here the current drawn by the primary winding at no load condition of the ideal transformer is used to produce the magnetic flux. That is, to magnetize this iron core, the current will be draws from the primary winding. Okay. So I will explain this principle in phasor diagram. So I am taking V1 is the reference. So that is V1, I am applying the input of the primary winding. Now by applying this V1 to the primary winding, the current will flow in the primary winding. That current is, I am telling, IL. Why? Because this current, which is used to magnetize the iron core, that means which is used to produce the magnetic flux. So here I am calling ideal transformer. Ideal transformer is the primary and secondary resistance are zero. The primary resistance will be zero. That means the primary winding which is in purely inductive nature. Okay. So that's why the current drawn by the primary winding at this time is lags V1 by 90 degrees exactly. So that is IM. Okay. So due to IM magnetizing current flowing through the primary winding, the flux will be produced. That flux is in phase with IM. Okay. Now this flux links with the primary winding at the same time, secondary winding by flowing through the iron core, and induced EMF will be produced in the primary winding and secondary. So the winding, the EMF which is induced in the primary winding is called E1, that is anti-phase with V1 according to Lenz law. So according to Lenz law, the induced EMF produced in the primary winding which will oppose the supply voltage V1. So that's why this E1 anti-phase with V1. So the angle between the V1 and E1 is 180 degrees exactly. Okay. At the same, the E2 will be E2 also, which is induced in the secondary winding, which will also anti-phase with V1 according to Lenz law. So this magnitude of E2 is depends upon the number of turns of the secondary winding. Okay. And this is the, I am taking by, and this is the IM. Okay, both are same. Okay, so here, ideal transformer is the resistance of the primary winding and secondary winding will be zero. So that's why the primary winding, which is the pure inductive nature, that's why the current IM will lag given by exactly 90 degrees. Okay, so in this time, it is not producing any losses. So the power input to the primary winding is, you can write V1 IM cos angle between V1 and IM. Okay. So what is the angle between V1 and IM? 90 degrees. So V1 IM cos 90 degrees. That is equals to 0. That means the output power will be 0. Okay, so if output power is 0, so the input power of the transformer also 0. That's why at ideal condition it does not produce any losses. Okay, this is about ideal transformer. Okay, now I will explain the practical transformer at a no load condition. Okay. Let us assume this is a practical transformer without load. So now in case of ideal transformer, it does not produce any losses. So ideally, so practically it is not possible. So the transformer at no load condition also, it has to produce some losses. So in this iron core, at no load condition producing two losses. One is the hysteresis losses. Second one is the eddy current losses. So by designing that designer always try to reduce this or decrease these losses. How means? This hysteresis losses can be reduced by using high grade silicon steel material. So by making this iron core with the high grade silicon steel material, you can reduce the hysteresis losses. By making this iron core as laminations, we can reduce the eddy current losses. Okay. So among these two losses are called hysteresis losses and eddy current loss. So those are called as iron losses or core losses. So among these iron losses and core losses, due to resistance of the primary winding, it is producing some copper losses at the primary winding. Okay. Now no load current. The current drawn by the primary winding is having two components. So that is no load current I am denoting with I0 which is having two components, nitrogen component and four last component. Okay, and this is also called not full component, not less component. And this is what? Full component. So at the practical transfer at normal condition, so the current transfer is a primary winding. I naught is having two components, one is the magnetizing component and second one is the core loss component. So this magnetizing component, which is used to produce the magnetic flux in the iron. And next, this iron, this what two component, or you can call it active component. So which is used to produce the some copper losses in the primary winding. So this is also called active component. And this is called, we can call reactive component. Now I will explain this this losses with the phasor diagram. Similarly, I am taking V is the reference. V1 is the reference. So by applying V, it is producing flux phi. So if you compare this operation with ideal transformer, in case of ideal transformer, the primary winding resistance will be zero, but here in practical, the primary winding having some resistance. Due to the resistance, here the current I naught lags V1 by some angle. So here I will explain. Now see, this IM is in phase with flux, and next this core loss component or Watt-foot component or active component is in phase with the V1 supply voltage, that is IC. So both vector sum of these two currents will be equals to I0. Okay. So due to primary resistance of the transformer, the no load current, that means the current drawn by the primary winding, is lags V1 by some angle, is what? That is phi. And now, similar, this is the E1 and this is the E2. Okay, this is the phasor diagram of the practical transformer at a no load condition. Okay, now from this phasor diagram, I can write IM equals to I0 cos sin pi0, IC equals to I0 cos pi0. Now I will write I0. So which is the phasor equivalence of both currents, that means we can write square root of IM square plus IC square. Now the power input to the transformer is W0. We can write V1 I0 cos phi. Here this I0 primary current drawn by the this winding is very less, that means this is 3 to 5% of the full load current. So this is very small current. So the copper losses produced by the primary winding will be then neglected. Why? Because it is a fraction of the full load current, 3 to 5%. So that's why I am neglecting the copper losses. So what is the remaining losses? Iron losses only. So this I0 component can write IC. Okay, so W0 equals to V1 IC cos phi0. So this is the power input to the practical transformer at no load condition. So that means this is also called, you can write iron losses or core losses. Why? Because this active component, what component which is supply the losses in the primary winding at no load condition. Okay, now I will explain primary practical transformer at load condition. At load condition, now if you connect the load to the secondary winding, the current I2 will be flows in the secondary winding. Okay, so here due to flowing of current in the secondary winding, it is producing MMF of N2 I2. So due to MMF of N2 and I2, it is producing a flux. So that flux is called pi2. Okay, this pi2 flux produced by secondary winding, pi2 will oppose the main flux, that is this flux, main field flux. Okay, it will oppose the main flux. Due to reducing in the magnitude of the main field flux, E1 will be decreases. The increasing EMF in the primary winding will be decreases. So due to decreasing in the magnitude of the inducing EMF in the primary winding, the difference between E1 and E1 will be increases. Okay. So resultant, due to variation of between E1 and E1, the primary winding consuming more power, that is called I2 dash. This is called load component current. Okay, what happening is, here due to load connecting on the secondary winding, the current I2 will be flows. Due to flowing of I2, there is an existence of MMF, that is called N2 and I2, N2 I2. So due to this MMF, the flux will be produced in the secondary winding, that is pi2. This pi2 will oppose the magnetic flux, main magnetic flux. So due to decreasing of magnetic flux, E1 will be decreases. Due to decreasing of E1, there is a difference between the E1 and E1, that will be increases. Due to increasing of E1, the primary winding draws more current from the supply. That current is called I2 dash. So that current is also called load component current. So because of load only, the primary winding taking the extra power from the supply, that extra current is called I2 dash. So this phase and this I2 dash, now due to flowing in the I2 dash in the primary winding, it is producing some flux in the primary winding, that is called pi2 dash. So this pi2 will oppose the pi2 dash will oppose the pi2 and help the pi1. That means the effect of pi2 on main field flux will be neutralized by this pi2 dash. Okay, now the remaining flux produced in the core is magnetic flux, that is pi1. Okay, what happened here? Due to I2 flowing in the primary winding, the flux pi2 dash will be exist on the primary. This pi2 dash opposes the pi2 and it will help the pi main field flux. That means it will neutralize the effect of pi2 on pi. So remaining flux in the magnetic core is pi1, original magnetic flux. That's why this transformer is always called constant flux device. Constant flux device. Now I will explain this load with the different phasor diagrams. Okay, this I2, the magnitude of the I2 and phase of the I2 is depends upon the load. If load is inductive in nature, I2 will lag V2 by some angle. If load is capacitive in nature, I2 leads V2 by some angle. And if it is resistive, so this I2 will increase into V2. So I will draw the phasor diagram simply. If load is inductive, say pi, I am taking flux as a reference, pi, and this is the supply voltage V1. Now here, in case of load condition, the primary current drawn by the primary winding having two components, that is I1 having two components, I0 and I1, I2 dash, okay, two components. So now I will draw the I0. So I0 is a vector equivalence of both currents, Im and I0, vector equivalence of these four currents will be I0. Now the EMF induced in secondary winding will be E2, which will oppose the E1 according to Lenz's law, and the same time E1 also. Now I2, if load is inductive in nature, the I2 will be lags E2 by some angle, that is called pi2. So I told I2 dash is with antiphase with I2, so I will draw the I2 dash which is antiphasic to this I2. So I dash. So vector equivalence of both this current called I1. So the angle between V1 and this I1 is called phi. Now for in capacitor, same phi is the difference, and this is the V1. E1 and E2 will both will be lags pi by 90 degrees. Next, and this is the IM and this is IC. Vector sum of both currents will be I0. And now, for capacitor load, this I2 will leads E2 by some angle. So this is the E2. The angle between both will be pi 2. Now I2 dash. So this I2 dash always antiphase with I2, so this is the I2 dash. No, now this vector sum of these both currents will be I1. So angle between this V1 and I1 will be pi. So this is the phase diagram of the practical transformer with the inductive load and capacitive load. Similarly, you can draw the for the resistive load also. For the resistive load, so these are I2 and E2 will be both will be in phase. Thank you so much.